Hi. While we're working on that, I'm Lygia. And while Patricia gave you some insight into the provider perspective, I'm going to be talking about the consumer or patient perspective. And she had a real focus on patient-generated health data in particular. I was thinking more about this question. We were asked to talk about adoption and what would make people get involved and actually use this stuff. And I was thinking about apps and tools and websites, that whole universe of stuff. I'm just going to get started and hope that my slides show up. So, all right. Always works. All right. So what's available today? So Ted covered some of this today. Basically, a lot is the takeaway. I felt I had to cite things because I was coming to the IOM, so there's a lot of words on there. But basically, this is also if people want to go and find the sources of some of this data, it's available. There are a number of reports in this really exploding consumer digital health area. So there are estimates that there are between 50 and 1,000 consumer health apps of one type or another. Many of them are related to exercise, wellness, fitness, eating kind of stuff, as opposed to more issues around measuring heart rate or other more specific, more kind of medical types of data. Today, these kinds of apps and tools are being adopted worldwide, and there are forecasts that there may be up to 68 million users in 2015. Most of those are generally cited to be in the US. And in general, again, having looked at a lot of reports, there's great predicted growth in use and adoption. I found one report that said that more than 70 million personal health and wellness products will be sold in the US alone by 2018. But the big takeaway, and that will generate more than $8 billion in product sales, software, and service revenues. So this is getting a lot of attention in the industry. The big takeaways are there are a lot, and this is exploding, no matter how you slice and dice it. Are people using this stuff? Kind of. Again, a whole lot of data on there. Takeaways. There's a great report from Pew, the Pew Internet Project, which says that 69% of adults currently track their health or the health of others. And when they talk about tracking, they mean it in a very general sense. That could be some of it is not even necessarily recording it, but just making sure you're following what you're eating, for example, or how many times you've been exercising. Interestingly, though, about 21% of trackers, not of all people, but just of that percent who's tracking, are using technology now. And folks with chronic conditions are among the more likely ones to actually do that. Again, another report here puts the number at, you know, roughly 10% of all adults are using an activity tracker. And this is very interesting to me, and this is a citation that I hear often. People say, well, this stuff isn't really effective anyway, because 50% of people who've owned an activity tracker stop using it, and 30% stop within 6 months. So I'm just using myself as an example. I have owned a number of activity trackers, some of which are, in fact, in a drawer, not being used. But it doesn't mean that I'm less engaged in my health or that they haven't had an impact. As an example, I remember after I had my first baby, I started using an online Weight Watchers program to try and lose those extra pounds. There were many of them. And I only used that for a couple of months, but there were lessons I took from it. For example, sorry, Starbucks, but I don't work for the government, so I can say things like this now. Don't buy the frozen Starbucks drinks. They're like a gazillion calories. I don't use that app all the time right now, but I don't buy the frozen Starbucks drinks. So I don't think a measure of success for an app or tool necessarily has to be, do I have it strapped to my body forever? I've also evolved in my own use of different products. Right now, I like wearing a Misfit Shine. I tried a Jawbone Up. Wasn't quite for me. I'm a veteran of a couple of Fitbits that, for one reason or another, weren't quite as good a fit for me as this right now. And it's partly because, oh, I see another. All right. anyway, so that's kind of an interesting question. The big takeaways here are, again, a lot of people are using this stuff, but I think we haven't nearly met the potential. You know, if, as Pew says, 69% of adults are already interested in and tracking something, and a smaller proportion of that are using these tools, I think that this agrees with the data from the last slide that basically the only way to go here is continued upward motion in terms of adoption. So okay, what do we adopt? What do we not adopt? There's like 40 or 50 or 100,000 of these things. How do we choose? And right now, there is no real guidance on what to use. And I would actually suggest that a potential role for the IOM might be, somebody mentioned early on, you know, creating standards. Well, maybe, but creating a rubric, a framework through which perhaps public and private sector entities could come together and help develop a code for, like, what's desirable in these things. This is kind of my code, pulled from a lot of ideas inspired by others and some of my own experience. You know, I will only use an app or tool or a device if it is useful. It's got to provide information of some kind that is valuable to me. It's got to be user-friendly. It better be like super easy plug and play, or I'm not going to use it. It better look good. And frankly, that's one of the reasons why I'm wearing the Misfit Shine. I don't like big, like, again, sorry, but like there's this better, possibly better in that it gives more data tracker provided by a company called Basis. It's wonderful, but it's like this huge calculator strapped to your arm. I can't wear that. I certainly can't wear it to meetings. So that doesn't work for me. It may work for some people, but good-looking design for whoever your demographic is. Got to be comfortable. It's got to be hardy. I have personally put Fitbits through the wash. I have actually dropped one once into a toilet because it was strapped onto my clothes. And the point is, you need something that's going to survive wear and tear and not just kind of fall apart. It's got to be affordable. This is an issue that's come up in a number of presentations. It's got to be accessible to a number of demographic groups. Also, for me, transparent privacy practices are really important. And I think for a lot of other people, I recently signed up for an app, Map My Run. And I got an email from one of my friends, or it was a text actually. She said, glad to know you're running, but it's a little creepy that they sent me a message that you're now mapping your run. And I was like, yeah, it's totally creepy. You didn't ask if you could send that to all my friends. I don't even know how that happened. And I was unhappy, and I still sort of hold it against that product. And I'm imagining that I'm not the only consumer that is going to feel incensed when we find our information is being used in ways that we weren't informed about. So also integration with other products, increasingly important, whether it's one of the platforms like Apple's HealthKit or any others. You know, increasingly, I hope we see a lot of use of APIs so that data can be pulled down from these devices and mashed up and shared, combined and shared in a variety of ways. Lastly, does it come from a trusted brand or are there trusted reviews? That is a factor. When I'm looking at, again, these tens of thousands of apps, tools, and devices, if I see one that's from a reputable brand, that will help be a differentiator. I'm not saying that I wouldn't buy something that's from a brand I've never heard of, but I will at least check online to see if they're, you know, if there's social wisdom saying this is a good thing and here's why. So those are kind of key factors. There are some other real motivators, I think, for people to adopt apps, tools, and technologies generally. So those ones are sort of like at the core, and these are some other sort of bonus ones. And we might all disagree about what's essential and what's a nice to have. But more incentives for using an app or a tool. Some of these are kind of intrinsic motivators. Is it fun? Somebody spoke earlier about what can we learn from games and gamification. Well, it turns out 59% of Americans play video games. And interestingly, I was surprised about this, 52% of them are male, 48% are female. So that's fairly even. And so, you know, what can we learn from games to sort of incorporate into the use of products to make them sticky? Tailored to the user's personal health goals and preferences. Again, if my goal is to fit into my lucky skinny jeans and that's what I want to do, I want a product that kind of speaks to me in those terms and that maybe helps me process information in ways in which I'd like it. I want to feel like it's really personalized for me and, again, relates to what I care about, not somebody else wants to improve my blood pressure measures or whatever it is. Another big motivator for some people can be that an app or tool helps them to contribute to society. And this is this idea of potentially donating your data or maybe improving the environment or something like that. So I just heard last week from one of the founders of this company, 23andMe, which sequences your genome, 80% of their participants are willing to share their data for research. a lot of people would love to contribute to something that helps improve health, even though we all feel that there are many privacy concerns, and I'm sure Allison will touch on those. This can be a strong motivator, too, that you're contributing to better health, better research. So on the extrinsic side, you know, others encouraging you to adopt or use some of these apps and tools, money is a big one. Potential sources of that might be an employer or a payer or a provider, an accountable care organization, or even a retail store, like a retail pharmacy. So examples, WellTalk is an app that employers offer that gives people incentives like coupons based on their healthy behaviors. Castlight helps you save money because you get to compare different potential services and see where you're gonna get the best deal. Money savings is the common theme there. But there are also extrinsic motivators that are more social in nature. You know, if everybody in your friend group is using, say, the Misfit Shine, maybe you'd better get one, because you want to be on board with them. Or touching on some of the comments made earlier today, you know, the provider plays a critical role in encouraging you to adopt or use a particular technology. There's an app I really like called Stick, in which you bet against your friends and you say, I'm going to, for example, go to the gym 3 times a day or 3 times a week. And if I am able to meet my goal, great. But if I don't, I give money to a cause I hate. So that's the motivator there. So what's on the horizon in terms of adoption and use? I think you'll see increasing use of extrinsic incentives. In other words, now a lot of these apps and tools are just sort of for sale, and it's like, do you want to buy them or not? I think we'll see more of the major players, from providers to payers to ACOs, who are motivated through policy changes to get consumers to be more engaged in their health. So we'll see more of that. I hope we'll see more evidence about what kinds of apps and tools and what characteristics are effective, because that, again, helps you slice and dice your way through the 40,000 plus, you know, what really works. I think we'll see consolidation of the market, hopefully informed by that greater evidence base. And increasingly, too, a blurring of the lines between health apps and tools and more generic ones. So, like, you wouldn't think about having a special health phone. And then you have a finance phone, and then you have a work phone, and then you have a social, you know, like, health is so integrated into the rest of what we do, and increasingly our health information and the sources we can pull from information that have to do with health are very diverse too, like what you buy at the grocery store. That's kind of health information. Who you talk to on the phone, who your social network is, that might be your health information. There are a lot of ways that it sort of seems artificial to designate things in as the strict boxes that we've used in the past. So a real blurring of lines here. And I think, hopefully, increased adoption and use of these tools in a way that they really fold into and become a ubiquitous part of our lives, again, in a way that helps us reach our own goals. Thanks.